MMA Inside the Cage, brought to you by Advanced Sports Labs.
All right, Casey Oxendine with MMA Inside the Cage, right here at Fight Summit with one of the greatest fighters in mixed martial arts history. It's Kevin the Monster Randleman. How you doing?
I'm awesome. Always good.
Man, I couldn't wait to get you out here, man. I wanted to go over some stuff. We were talking earlier about, you know, how you got into the sport, what was going on at the time. So could you recap that a little bit for the viewers and, you know, kind of give an insight of who Kevin Randleman is, where he came from, and all that?
Just like a lot of people, I'm one of 11 kids. I got a lot of family members. We weren't rich. We were actually, you know, kind of like, I mean, we were poor. So didn't have a lot of money, and my only way to get out was to go to college. I always fought in the streets, you know, being a kid. And I mean, I don't want to say I was ghetto or anything like that, but, you know, when you don't have money, you fight. You learn how to do a lot of things. I went to college. I went to the Ohio State University and met Mark Coleman. And I hate bullies. You know, I don't care who you are, what it is. You know, I'm against bullies 110%. I don't care where I'm at. If I see someone bullying someone just because they think that they're better, I'm going to go off on them. That's how I am. And I don't think of myself. I put other people before me. So a lot of times I'm going to get in a lot of fights. So if someone disrespects some ladies with me, I'm going to fight them. So my boys, Mark Coleman and them, they always saw me fighting guys in the streets and the bars because they were getting smart with us. Remember, I'm not a big guy. I can't believe it. I just threw my height out there. You know, I'm not a big guy. And in college, I was 5'8", wrestling 170. So I wasn't a big guy fighting. And I was fighting guys that were big 260. So Mark Coleman saw how relentless and how aggressive I was and how much I could fight. And when he became the UFC champ, everyone always asks you if you have anyone that you train with. So the first thing in his mind was like, yeah, Kevin Randleman. I was that. And at the time, I had a son. And I wanted to go home. I wanted to raise him. I wanted to be with him. I wanted to spend more time with him. So we had a gym, and I was managing the gym back in Ohio. And Coleman called me and said, hey, you want to fight? I said, nah, man. I'm like, I'm cool. I'm right here with my son. I'm watching WWE. And he said, $30,000 if you win. I said, who do I got to kill? He said, you just got to win 3 matches in one night. And I said, what do I got to do? He said, there's a ticket for you at the Cleveland airport. Your fight's in 28 days. I flew to Arizona. I trained with Mark Coleman and Mark Kerr. Went to Brazil. Fought a brawl in which we didn't wear gloves. This is when it was real.
Right. Yeah, that's what we were talking about earlier. A lot of people that are watching mixed martial arts now, and they've just been in it the last couple of years, they don't realize the evolution. You were back there at the inception of what was then no-holds-barred fighting. You know, there were no gloves. The rules were a whole lot different, man. You know, you could get your head kicked off, you know, on the ground, you know.
And then there wasn't a rule. There was no rules when I started, especially in Brazil. In Brazil, they just let you kind of go. It was a free-for-all. I remember they made me put gloves on. In my first match, I look across the ring, and the guy across the ring doesn't even have gloves on. I'm like Rocky in that movie. I'm trying to take my gloves off, and the dude's coming at me. I get my gloves off, take the dude down. I mean, it was bloody. Every fight I had in Brazil was very, very painful and traumatic for my face.
Right. Well, now, the first time I remember seeing you, the one that stood out, of course, was your fight with Maurice Smith, because Maurice Smith had just beaten Mark Coleman. It was a big deal because that was the big striker versus wrestler fight, you know, and a lot of people felt that that ushered in the striker in mixed martial arts. And then here comes Kevin Randleman on the scene, man. You were huge. You were a monster. You beat him. You go out. You fight Pete Williams. You take the belt from Pete Williams. And then here comes Bob Rootin in that fight. You know, a lot of people felt you won the fight.
I know you're going to see this, boss. I know you're going to see this. I'm just doing this right now, El Guapo, just so that you know I love you.
A lot of people felt that you won that fight. What is your take on it, and how do you think that changed the scoring system in mixed martial arts?
I tell you, before the fight, you know, everyone always likes to build stuff up. And I'm one of those guys, you can hype me up. If you tell me that someone says something negative about me, if I see them in the hallway, I'm fucking going right at them right there. Excuse my language. So that's me. I don't talk bad about anybody. I like every fighter in this business except for one, and that's Tito Ortiz. I'll fight him in a New York minute. But everyone else, I believe in respect. You respect me, I respect you. That's, you know, kind of how. But with Boss and I happened to catch each other in the elevator. I was getting ready to get on, and he was in the elevator, and I was like, I'll take the next one. He was like, all right. And I said, hey, if you don't kick, we can stand up and throw him. He's like, okay. What do you think the first thing he did when I ran across the ring?
Kicked you.
Front kick to the face. And that was it. It was on. It was a war. But the best thing about it is, like, then I didn't understand anything about this business.
Right.
And everyone was trying to outlaw us. So we were just trying to get in every fight that we could get in because we thought it was going to be outlaw. We never thought it was going to grow into this. We didn't know it was going to be take a life of its own and grow. But during that fight, Boss and I talked. It was the only fight that I've ever talked to someone in during a fight. His face was bleeding. The blood was in his eyes. And I just remember raking the blood out of his eyes. And he was like, is it bad? And I'm like, yeah, it's pretty bad. And he started hitting me with elbows. And my head started bleeding. Greatest thing, one of my greatest friends that I've ever got through this whole entire fight thing is Boss Rutten. He is crazy.
Right.
But at the same time, he's, you know, when you think of MMA, you have to always think of Boss Rutten. Because he's the epitome of what MMA was. He lived it all of his life. Not like me. You know, I went to college and did other stuff. I played some arena ball for 2 years and stuff like that. So it wasn't all my life, but he did it all his life.
Yeah, one of the most incredible characters ever in MMA also.
Yeah, I love him. I love him. I love his beautiful, I love his family. You know, they were at my wedding. And, you know, we've been just very good friends ever since.
So do you think you won the fight?
And again, beautiful family. Love them. They're great. You know, I lost that fight, and in the record books, no matter what, I lost that fight. So I don't even like going back and forth to that.
Very nice. All right, let's fast forward to the Pride years.
Oh, I'm sorry, but the best thing about that fight, it changed the whole entire game of MMA. Because that was the last time the fights went 20 minutes. Boss and I fought for 20 minutes straight. They said that there was no clear winner, so then they made us fight 3 more minutes. After that fight, that was the last long fight. After that, they went to rounds, 5-minute rounds for championships and 3-minute rounds for regular fights.
Yeah, and they scored the takedowns a lot more heavily after that as well, top position and takedowns. So, yeah, very.
I think it changes. You know, like the MMA guys are doing, there's like, it grows. It's, you know, just like a baby. Jiu-jitsu guys will learn how to defend the wrestlers. The wrestlers will learn the jiu-jitsu and be able to defend the submissions. And we're all learning the stand-up so that we can knock you to where we want you. You know, it's just the most beautiful sport in the world, because if you understand the mixed martial arts game, you can see the advancement of it all. From Henzo Gracie and Kimo back in the day with the cross, you know, giving it into Mayhem Miller in Japan with guys spinning on their heads. You know, this is a business, but at the same time, it's entertainment, and it's stressful enough for us.
Right.
You know, we can't have people around us stressing us out, too.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely. Now, let's talk Japan, okay? So, the Pride years. So, you head into Pride. It's a different environment, okay? You said you'd been in Brazil. You'd fought in America. You head into Pride. When you got there, you know, what was it like? You know, what were the differences, you know, both culturally and, you know, in the ring at the time? You know, how was that different, and what was your experience like there?
Okay, when it comes to fans, and I know there's going to be some people that are going to take me wrong on this, but I don't really give a shit. When it comes to fans, the Japanese fans are the best fans in the world. Why? Because you don't get booed in Japan. If you get booed in Japan, you'll probably never fight in Japan again because you fought that bad. They sit, they listen, they understand when there's nothing going on and you're on the ground rolling around that they could hear a break. So they're quiet, like church mice. America, guy gets taken down on the ground for freaking 15 minutes. I hear boos. I want to smack every single one of you fans that sit up there and boo us in the ring because you don't got enough action. Get in the cage with anybody. Everybody out there that's never been smacked in their face and been punched in their face, they love trying to say exactly what they would do if they got in there. I'll smack anybody that says they could do better. If you've never been in the cage, Mad Madison. This young lady right here has got more intestinal fortitude than most people out there on their couches sitting there trying to email us and talk junk to us on them blogs. This young lady right here has got punched in her face, and I give her more respect than half of you fans out there. So when you guys go to a UFC event and I hear you booing, don't ever get mad because someone goes off on you guys because you're disrespecting our art. You're disrespecting our love, our baby, and you're going to boo us? Get a clue. If you don't understand the game, then the game can be taught to you. You know, I mean, there's all kinds of sites. You know, all you got to do is go back in the day. There's people that don't even know that Henzo, that the Gracie started this thing. Some people think that, some people literally think that Matt Hughes and Henzo Gracie started it when it was done back in the day with hoisting them. So I just believe people have a problem with not understanding the beauty of what they're watching. So when I hear people boo, when I see a fight like where two guys are just really, I know what they're going through because it's, you're trying to fight from getting your arm snapped in half. And if you don't just keep this position, it's going to get snapped, but there's nothing going on, so people boo. Me, I used to feed off of them, and they would boo, and I just do stupid. I would make it more exciting and lose a lot of fights. Right. So now I'm not even letting my fighters ever. Don't listen to the boos because they don't know shit.
Right.
And I don't go to fights anymore just because of that reason. Because I've been in the audience, and I've heard people yell and booing, and those people in my area, I stand up and cuss them out. You know, you got some pair of balls on you to boo Anderson Silva and Chael Sonnen because of how Anderson's fighting. Anderson's pushing himself. You know, if we all have to do what we have to do to make our lives interesting for ourselves. We live on the edge.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry.
No. This is exactly what we want to hear, man.
Fucking fake ass fan.
But in Japan, you said the fans were fantastic.
The fans, it's different. It's like they understand the warrior mentality. They know there were guys in Japan that would make their will out. Sign a will in case they got hurt and couldn't do anything, that someone could take care of their family. This is how hard they went into it. Japanese fans, they sit there and they understand.
Yeah.
They just understand. They don't boo. And they're not up yelling and screaming. They watching it. Literally, I'm in the fight fighting Crow Cop. And during the fight, didn't think twice about it. But as I watched the replay, the hardest fucking punch I've ever, when I hit him, it echoed in the whole entire, because they were silent.
Right.
You heard that pop and then everyone erupted. But that's how the fans are. They want to see everything the transitions. They really, Brazilian fans, they're good fans. Oh my God, I love them too. They know the action. They're not booing or anything. They just know that there's always action going.
Right.
They're great fans too. I'm an American man, and I get booed. I hate hearing boos from my own, you know. Sure, I'm gonna get a lot of flack on this, and I really give a shit. But this is our job, and this is what we do. You know, and we're always looking for a way to feed our families, and our whole entire lives on the line.
Yeah.
You can't die in this sport. That's why people are trying to outlaw it. That's why we went from the rounds that we had, the way we had it, to now. That's why the Las Vegas Athletic Commission and every athletic commission in every state, they have a huge responsibility to make sure that we're safe. Because we're fighters. We don't care. We'll get in there and do it. We don't, no gloves or whatever. If you're going to pay me, that's kind of the mentality that we have. We don't want to be hurt and maimed for the rest of our lives. So we're thankful for the athletic commissions all over the country, all over the world, doing their due diligence to make sure we have rounds, the doctors, CAT scans before and after. If you're 40 years older like me, you got to go through a bunch of steps to get, you know, It's great the way the sport is now.
Well, now, speaking of rules, you know, back in the Pride days, you know, this is something that a lot of people talk about, and we're talking about physical enhancement. We're talking performance-enhancing drugs over in Japan. I want to get the scoop, man. You know, you saw it all. You were there from the start to the finish. What was going on? How many of those guys were truly on performance-enhancing drugs, and how do you think that affected their performance?
Honestly, I don't think that there's some guys that, okay, first of all, I don't know what anyone else does. I'll say what I can only talk on me. In my career, I've done a lot of things. I've taken a lot of bad stuff. When I was in Japan, I was just a crazy son of a bitch. It wasn't performance enhancing as, you know, more of the stuff I did was detrimental to my career than enhancing my career. So I don't know what other guys did, but you know, I wasn't. I'm only 5'10". I mean, I'm 5'10". So when I weigh 220 pounds, I look like I'm 240. I was a UFC heavyweight champion at 199. I won it weighing 199. Check the books. That's what I weighed in at. When I fought Randy Couture, I only weighed like 210. I was always trying to keep my weight on. And then when I went to Japan, because I have a I don't give a fuck attitude, and Mark Coleman, they would offer Mark Coleman these heavyweights. I wanted to fight the light heavyweight with Vanderlei Silva and all those guys. But because Mark Coleman, sometimes if he would get injured or broke his neck once, and I filled in, and I won. So they said, oh my gosh. And then it's almost like they fed me to anyone. So as far as the performance enhancing, I'm sorry, but every sport has them. Every sport has them. And that's why the athletic commissions, and that's why there's drug tests. Now, granted, don't get me, I love Japan because they really helped me learn and grow as a man. I'm a better man for all my friends, family, because of the Japanese people and how respectful they are and how diligent they are in their job. But I'm sure there is. I'm just like every sport. I'm sure there is some. And hell, badminton, I'm sure they got a little something going on there too, whether it be speed or whatever. But for me, I mean, I've done things. I've had doctors prescribe me things, and that's it. I've never failed a drug test. I had some fake urine because I went through a bunch of shit. I had a lot of injuries. I had 16 surgeries over the last 6 years of my life. Almost died twice. So I was always on pain pills.
Yeah, we talked about that earlier. You had, the lung. You had surgery on your lung, and then you also had that horrendous staph infection in your rib cage there. Tell us a little bit about that.
I just want to finish up with the enhancement part. I just think that there's a lot of things that are too blown out of proportion. Because there are, for a 40-year-old man, I think testosterone replacement is very, very, it's imperative for them. For us guys, when we get older, we lose our stamina and our energy, and that helps us able to freaking get up and do more, clean more. You know, and I'm not saying it's for everyone, but when you're 30 years old, you don't need that shit. Bust your ass all your life, and you don't need it. It's those people that like to. It's those people that just they're lazy. Everybody knows who you are. It's those lazy guys that want that extra edge. If you don't have it, you're not gonna have it with that. Enhancements are not gonna make you come out and beat me. Enhancements is gonna get you tired, and I'm a warrior. I'm gonna keep coming. When you take that stuff, you get out of shape. You know, I'm sorry, you're not gonna just, you know, so, and you can look at those guys and say, hey, he's on something. I'm sorry, you know, it's not, it doesn't take a rocket scientist. But I'm not ever putting anyone on the bus because, you know, I've been proclaimed to be a steroid guy and an enhancing guy too. People that meet me, they're like, geez, I can't even believe you're the same guy. Yeah, I know, I'm not 6'7" with fireballs coming out of my ass, and you know, it's a sport. It's just a sport, just like every other sport. Everyone's going to try and get the upper edge. If you're smart about it and you get, you know, the right people behind you, then you can do phenomenal things. But as far as the enhancing thing, when you're 20 years old, you don't need it. When you're 30, you don't need it. When you're 40, no. I like being real, and I just don't want people to take anything that I say wrong.
Right.
You know, I'm saying it because there's just too many people trying to get involved to regulate things. They didn't give a shit about this a long time ago. Now everyone wants to get in and put their hands in and say, I want this, I want that. You want in New York, you got to kiss people's butts and take people out to dinner just so John Jones can fight in his own state. Doesn't make sense to me. It shouldn't have to go through so many hoops for people that didn't like it. And there's over 40 states that already approved it. The other states should have to jump on board too. I don't know.
Well, real quick, two things. I want two questions. The first question is, Kevin Randleman, you know, out of all of the accomplishments that you've made, the UFC title, you know, two things stand out to me, you know, big moments for you. One, of course, people never forget is the big Fedor suplex. Even though you didn't win that fight, that was incredible. And then, of course, the big left hook that finished off Krokop in Pride. That was a big moment. But for you, what was the biggest moment in your career ever? What stands out the most, and what do you think that you're going to be remembered for the most?
What for me, what stands out the most to me in my career, it's not something that you'll ever be able to see. I was fighting Ninja Rua, and up until that point I was just a nervous wreck. I love fighting. If you say this dude wants to fight you, I'm like, let's go. I'm not gonna say, whoa, it's on. I'm not gonna I'm not taking a step back. I'm Spartacus, I'm Spartan. But my boys were like, you're jumping off the wall, man. You're getting so tired before you fight. And one of the greatest moments in my career for me, it was an inner win. Because I learned how to relax. That Ninja fight, they said, man, you gotta take a pillow and sleep. And I took a pillow to the arena. I found a closet. Fell asleep for like 2 hours, 40 minutes before my fight. They woke me up like, dude, you gotta get you ready. I'm like, I'm okay, man. Back off me, I'm good. Got in the fight, it was one of my better fights. Punches never, you know, I fought really well. And from that day on, I learned how to take steps back. So I can, you know, I'm always ready. I'm not able to catch up with myself because I'm always going so fast. You know, so for me, that was one of the a special moment for me was that whole entire Japanese. I mean, I learned a lot about myself.
Well, the last question is, you know, you're still a relatively young man. What's next for Kevin Randleman?
I'm still banging. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I've had a lot of injuries, and you know, I'm writing an autobiography and everything. I don't hold any shorts on my book because I ain't gonna hold any shorts in public. The only reason why I don't say more expletives because there's mad Madison's right over here. I don't want her to beat me up, so I got to be a little respectful. But you can catch me on my autobiography. Is going to definitely tell you everything. It's going to be all the good, the bad, the ugly, everything. And I'm sure there's going to be some people that are not going to like it, but it's my life and it's my story. And believe me when I say there's going to be people that are going to learn from it. And those are the people that I'm selling it. Believe me, I'm writing this book because it's amazing. I've done so much crazy stuff that I'm still here. And I still love it just as much as I did the first day that I got to fight, you know?
Well, Kevin, you know, love you or hate you, you know, for whatever you say, you know, people are going to have to respect you. And, you know, it's been a pleasure to sit here and talk to you. You know, is there anything else before we sign off that you want to say to the crowd? You said a few things to the bad fans. What do you have to say to the good fans, the guys that have supported Kevin Randleman, you know, throughout your entire career?
I'm going to say this to all the fans in general, period. Everyone's got something that they enjoy. And if you do enjoy the things that we do for you at the fans, just keep letting us know it. You know, I'm one of those guys that I answer every fan. I don't have somebody that auto replies my stuff. I take 1 weekend out of my whole entire month every month and write back to my fans. And sometimes they put their numbers in there and I call them. My wife can't stand it because my bill 1 month was like $700 because I called some dude in Pakistan. And you know, the fans are, without the fans, there would not be this MMA summit. You know, so the fans are the reason why we're having this success, and that there's going to be a whole another women's division for Mad Madison to become a champion like she wants to be. And I mean, it's got something for everyone. And that's the beauty of MMA. It's not for the young, it's not for the old, it's for everyone to feel good about themselves. So when you're a fan, don't boo us. We're doing this for you. We're getting cut and bleeding and going to the hospital after the fight for you guys. So at least let us do what we do, and instead of booing, clap.
Very nice. Well, Kevin, it's been an honor. Thank you so much.
Yes, it was an honor.
Well, thank you.
For me, yeah.
Oh, my goodness, man. Well, this is... No, I'm not going to mess with you, man. This is Casey Oxendine right here with Kevin, the Monster Randleman, and we're signing off.
As a professional fighter, there's a lot of things that I need to be concerned about. I need to be concerned about my opponent. I need to worry about my fans. I don't want to have to be concerned about my blood work. That's why I go to Advanced Sports Labs, and I get my blood work done in an affordable manner. They get it done fast. They send it to the commission, they send it to the promoter, and they send it to me, so I have peace of mind knowing that everything's done properly.
As a promoter, they've taken away the headache of trying to get the blood work and get the results to the state. They have streamlined the process, and they do it at a great affordable rate for the fighter and for the promotion.
Expedite your blood work today at AdvancedSportsLabs.com.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. Your front row seat, 7 days a week, to experience all the hard-hitting action, news, and entertainment from around the fight world. From world-class boxing events.
Here we go, the main event!
To mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups.
Here we go!
Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Fight Now TV also offers unrivaled access to the fighters and insiders who make the fight game happen around the globe. As we go from the training camps to the weigh-ins, press conferences to the matchups, Fight Now TV is there before and after every belt. Fight Now TV also features original series found only on Fight Now.
There you have it.
Stop on by.
It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV.